2019.
The art world, where paintings change hands for fortunes.
Selling at $95 million.
But for every known masterpiece, there may be another still waiting to be discovered.
Well, that's it.
Well, that's it, isn't it?
That is it. That is our painting.
International art dealer Philip Mould and I have teamed up to hunt for lost works by great artists. We use old-fashioned detective work and state-of-the-art science to get to the truth.
Science can enable us to see beyond the human eye.
Ta-da! Oh, wow!
The problem is, not every painting is quite what it seems.
You successfully faked Lowry's even while you were at school, didn't you?
Yes.
It's a journey that can end in joy.
Oh, dear.
Isn't that great?
It's more wonderful.
Or bitter disappointment.
I can't cope with this roller coaster.
What a nightmare.
In this episode, could a painting hanging in a Scottish castle be a work by 19th century French master Paul Delaroche?
Oh my goodness, that looks nearly identical.
A £500 picture might be a lost royal treasure.
Not just a painting with a provenance, but a fantastically gilded, elevated one.
Our investigation takes us to a French chateau in search of a cherished gift from a king to his queen.
Wow.
We're led on a turbulent trail through revolution and bloodshed.
So your painting, if it is by Delaroche, witnessed some of the most dramatic events in French history.
This is St. Amélie, this is it.
But will we do enough to help one woman in her quest to prove her late husband was right?
I mean, he really believed it was a Delaroche, so if we can prove it, it would be something very special.
Called to the far corners of the country to help viewers investigate their mysterious works of art. This case brings us north of the border to Aberdeenshire and the beautiful county of Banff. We've been contacted by a family who think there might be a missing masterpiece hanging in their B&B. And what a B&B it is. This is Castle of Park, built in the 16th century. Many a laird has lived here over the past 500 years, but it's now home to the Wilson family and their guests.
Hiya, who are you?
I'm Archie.
Archie, nice to meet you.
How do you do, Archie?
Hiya, Fiona, hi.
Hi.
Hi there, hi.
Hi.
Becky,
hi.
Yes,
hi.
Nice
hi.
To see you.
Hello,
nice
how
to meet
do you
all.
Do?
Do you want to
come in?
Yeah, thank you.
The Wilsons moved here in 2007, and Becky has worked hard to restore the castle, filling the rooms with antiques and hanging the walls with art.
All these gorgeous paintings on the wall.
And here's Neil's painting.
Becky has asked us here to see a mysterious picture owned by her late husband, who was an art dealer.
Oh, a portrait of a kneeling medieval queen, it looks like.
Absolutely beautiful, Becky. I can see why your husband loved it so much. And what do you know about it?
I don't know a lot. I know he bought it when he left university, when he was working at Christie's. This was one of the first pictures he bought there.
And when was that?
It's in 1989. And he bought it for about £500. It's not signed. It wasn't attributed to anybody. He just liked it because it was a beautiful picture.
So it was just an anonymous painting?
Yes, absolutely. It was only later, after he'd been working, you know, a lot longer in the art world, that he had a hunch that it was painted by Delaroche.
So by Paul Delaroche, the great early 19th century French history painter. I mean, a name to conjure with.
Paul Delaroche was a phenomenon in his day. Born in 1797, he made his name in Paris in the 1820s and 30s, painting famous scenes from history and religion. Joan of Arc in prison. The death of Elizabeth I. The princes in the tower. Delaroche's potent mix of high drama and human emotion made his works hugely popular. And thanks to the production of prints copied from his paintings, he became a household name across Europe and beyond. But after his death in 1856, tastes changed and his work fell out of fashion. Now Delaroche is making a comeback, which means if this is a lost work, it has currency.
So Neil bought it in 1989 for £500. So if it is a genuine Delaroche, Philip, what would it be worth?
Well, given that it's a really entrancing image, and I think that's going to make a big difference, if it is a genuine work by him, I can see it being worth £50,000.
Wow. That would be a heck of a return on his investment, wouldn't it?
It would, yeah.
So he must have been pretty excited about it, Becky. Did he get anyone else to look at it?
Yes, there was a Delaroche exhibition at the National Gallery in 2010. So he took it down to the National Gallery, but the experts were not 100% sure. They couldn't confirm that it was a Delaroche.
How frustrating. And so was he able to do any more research on it?
He didn't. No, he didn't have time to look at it then. And then when he did get around to doing it, he unfortunately became ill, so it was sort of just put on the back burner.
In 2012, Neil was diagnosed with a brain tumour and given months to live. Becky gave up work to care for him at home, and he fought on for a year and a half. But Neil passed away in June 2014.
How old was he, Becky?
He was 48.
Oh. Yeah. So this is very raw recent history for you.
Yeah,
I'm so sorry.
But if this is a Delaroche, it would be fantastic.
So before Neil got ill, and despite being told that it couldn't be proved as a genuine Delaroche, did he continue to believe that it was?
Yes, absolutely.
So we need to prove him right, don't we?
Do it for him. And for all of you.
Yes, yeah.
I'm keen to get the investigation underway by having a closer look at the physical evidence, the painting itself.
Now that I'm looking at it closer, I can begin to see why it's working its magic. There are some beautiful areas of exquisite detail, of really affecting power. And also there's a rather surprisingly daring juxtaposition of colours, the sort of thing you might expect Delaroche to do. He was known for his boldness, his courage in that respect. And one of the things that I also find reassuring and would suggest that it's not a modern fake is the craquelure, the drying cracks, the aging cracks. They're very difficult things to reproduce if you're trying to forge a picture of this date. But before one gets too excited at the thought that we're dealing with a picture that was done during Delaroche's lifetime, could it in fact be by a copyist? Could it in fact be by someone who had been taught by Delaroche, who'd learned his techniques, who'd got insights into how to apply the paint? And you just can't rule out these rather dark possibilities at this stage. But there's enough here, enough evidence of quality, for me to want to find out more.
There's a lot at stake here for Becky and her boys. Neil's illness has taken its toll on every aspect of their lives.
Now, I'm very aware as we talk about this painting that you have had a really tough couple of years.
Yeah, big changes, lots of changes. But even before he died, there were lots of changes because he was so ill. He'd lost all his short-term memory and obviously his balance. And it did, it's quite character changing as well, a brain tumour. But he never lost his sense of humour and he never lost his long-term memory. So he could still beat us at Trivial Pursuit and Scrabble and things.
And he still knew who you all were.
He knew who we all were. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm just so conscious as we talk about this painting, obviously we have a job to do and we will do it for you. But this has a whole different meaning for you.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
It's intensely personal to you. If we do manage to prove that this is a genuine Delaroche, what will you do with it?
I really don't know, because it's such a beautiful picture and it's so much to do with Neil that I would love to keep it. But £50,000 is a lot of money, so, and it would help a lot with easing a few, financial issues. But obviously income is a lot less than it was before, and so we've started running a B&B from the house. So that brings income in to pay to stay here and not move out of the house.
Is that a possibility otherwise, that you'd actually have to move?
Yes, I think so. I don't have enough other income coming in to live here.
So we really need to prove that this painting is by Delaroche.
Yeah, it'd be fantastic.
Mm. Right. We'll do our best, Vicky.
OK.
We absolutely will, I promise.
Fantastic. Yeah.
I hope we can help finish what Neil started. We're leaving Castlehaugh Park with a huge sense of responsibility.
I can't help feeling that this investigation, it matters more than any we've ever done.
Yeah, this is more than art history, isn't it? This is about trying to prove the beliefs of a man who's no longer around to do so himself.
Back in London, we're retracing Neil's footsteps to see how far he'd got with his research. Becky told us that back in 2010, he took his painting to the National Gallery. A big exhibition was being staged around one of the most popular paintings in the collection, Delaroche's monumental work, The Execution of Lady Jane Grey.
So this is the painting that Neil hoped his picture would hang beside. This is Delaroche's masterpiece, of course, The Execution of Lady Jane Grey. She was queen for just 9 days. And this is clearly her at the point of execution.
I mean, it's an astonishing picture, though, isn't it? And it shows you what he was about. He plundered history. He found those moments of human predicament. It's almost like drama. You're drawn into that terrible moment, that poor woman, or girl rather, 17 years old, you know, feeling for the block. It's like a still from a film, isn't it? You can see the seeds of Hollywood in this.
I've read that this is such a popular painting here at the National Gallery that the floor has to be regularly revarnished because so many people stand and just gaze at this.
And of course, it's not just today. In 1834, when Paul Delaroche exhibited this picture and made his reputation, it caused an absolute sensation.
Can you see anything in this painting that would indicate that Neil's could be by the same hand?
I mean, there's something about the way the silks are done, the way they catch the light and shimmer, the glow in the flesh of the cheeks. You know, this is a beautiful observation I think we see in ours. I think there are enough details that are similar, enough stylistic traits to make a really good case for Neil's picture being by Delaroche.
I've discovered from my contacts at the National Gallery that Neil had been following some intriguing leads before he became ill. I'm with Becky, following his trail to the British Museum, where Neil had made an exciting discovery. We've come to the prints and drawings room to see what he'd uncovered.
So, Becky, do you happen to know how far Neil managed to get in his researches on this picture?
No, I don't know. I mean, he didn't really talk to me about what he did with his art, and I didn't talk to him about what I did with my accounting.
Well, it sounds like a good arrangement.
Yeah.
Well, actually, he'd been up to a bit of super sleuthing, and he managed to establish that there was a connection between your painting and two images that reside in this museum.
OK.
Here is one of them.
Gosh. Gosh, that's very similar, isn't it?
This is a preparatory drawing by none other than Paul Delaroche himself for an oil painting that he was then going to go and paint.
Gosh.
So it's the earliest stage, as it were, in the preparation for something quite significant.
I mean, there's quite, yeah. I mean,
you recognise it?
Yes, I do. I mean, there's quite a lot of differences, but the faces are very similar, aren't they?
Well, there's more than one piece to this jigsaw, because over here is another image in the museum which relates to your painting.
That looks nearly identical.
This is an engraving by Paolo Mercuri done in 1837. Now, the point is, it's after an original painting by Paul Delaroche. The painting is nowhere to be found. There is a missing link between this drawing and that engraving. So the question is your painting this missing link?
Okay.
But there is another aspect to this. If we can prove that this is the lost work by Paul Delaroche, it doesn't just become a lost painting by a fascinating and important artist, it is also a royal commission.
Wow.
Because the lost painting had been commissioned by none other than the last king and queen of the French, Marie-Amélie and Louis-Philippe, thus making it not just a painting with a provenance, but a painting with a fantastically gilded, elevated one.
Wow. Gosh, I didn't realise that at all.
Well, I have to say, it raises the stakes.
Yeah. That's something quite special, isn't it?
It would be something to discuss in the guest house, wouldn't it?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yes, definitely.
So we're now dealing with a possible lost royal treasure. At the gallery, we're meeting with our specialist art researcher, Dr. Bendor Grosvenor, to see what evidence we've got so far.
Here's the man at the centre of our mystery, artist Paul Delaroche.
And we need to establish whether Neil's picture is by Delaroche and painted for the last king and queen of the French.
And here they are, King Louis-Philippe and Queen Marie-Amélie. And they lived through a tumultuous time in French history. There was revolution, rebellion, culminating ultimately in their overthrow in 1848.
And by all accounts, Marie-Amélie was very religious, and it's documented that in 1831, Paul Delaroche was commissioned to paint a picture of her patron saint, Saint Amélie, and it was designed to be a model for a stained glass window in the Queen's private chapel.
And we've seen the original sketch by Delaroche for this design, but experts say that the original picture is lost.
And it's clearly an important painting, commissioned for the Queen, no less, and of her patron saint.
Well, in fact, it was important enough to be exhibited in the prestigious Paris Salon of 1834. Here's the catalogue entry, Saint Amélie, and it says there that the picture belonged to the King.
Does it list the dimensions of the lost picture?
It doesn't, but I have found an exhibition catalogue from 1857, which states very clearly that the dimensions were 42 centimetres high and 28 centimetres wide.
So, Neil's is 44. This is 29. Well, that's a bit of a worry, isn't it? Because if this painting is the lost original, you'd expect the dimensions to be the same.
Yeah, and there's also other niggling concerns. I mean, we know that the engraving is a copy of the lost picture. For Neil's to be the lost picture, they've therefore pretty well got to look identical. Unfortunately, there are some differences. I wonder whether you can spot them.
Well, if you look at the plant pot, for example, or the jardiniere, if you want to be fancy about it, in Neil's painting it's completely plain, whereas in the engraving it's richly decorated.
And the face of the middle servant in Neil's picture is far less detailed than the one you see in the engraving.
And then there's the cloth. In the engraving it's a richly decorated material, whereas in Neil's painting, it's just like a bit of canvas.
And have a look at the step in the engraving. You can see beautifully clearly in Gothic writing, Delaroche. In the painting, there is nothing.
But I wonder if that inscription might have been added by the engraver, because sometimes engravers used to do that, used to fiddle with pictures and add little bits in.
Yeah, and I also think there is possibly another explanation, and that is some later restorer has touched in areas, has changed them, skewing the eye and making the experts think that it's a copy.
Well, forensic analysis should help us with that. And I want to find out more about the original painting, its royal connection, and how a royal treasure could be lost.
To find out more about Delaroche's lost Saint Amélie, owner Becky and I are travelling to France. We've come to Normandy, and the glorious Chateau d'Eux. Built in the 16th century, this was once the summer palace of King Louis-Philippe and Queen Marie-Amélie. After a turbulent period of rebellion and revolution, in 1830, Marie-Amélie and Louis-Philippe were crowned King and Queen of the French.
Wow, what an incredible room.
They immediately set about transforming their dilapidated chateau into a fabulous royal palace. By the time work was finished, the chateau contained 60 apartments and 250 bedrooms. As part of the renovations, the king requested Delaroche design a stained glass window that would hang in the Queen's chapel. I'm hoping it can shed some light on Neil's painting.
So, Becky, if your painting is by de la Roche, this is the man who commissioned it. King Louis-Philippe, in honour of his wife. There she is, Queen Marie-Amélie.
OK.
They came to the throne and they surrounded themselves with the trappings of royalty, and they invited Queen Victoria and Prince Albert over here to Chateau d'Eure in 1843. And that was not only just to cement their friendship, but also to bolster the French monarchy with a bit of the stardust of the British monarchy and its stability.
The young Victoria wrote of the visit in her journal, and she mentioned something that might be of interest to Becky.
Now, I've got a copy of her diary entry here. Have a look at that, See if you can read her writing.
OK, so at 3:30, the King and Queen fetched us and showed us over the greater part of the chateau. The little chapel is beautiful, full of stained glass windows and figures of saints.
And, of course, one of those windows was conceived from the original de la Roche painting.
Yeah.
Which we hope is yours.
Yeah.
The curator of Chateau d'Eure, Alban Dupin, has agreed to show us Queen Marie-Amélie's chapel. He's warned us it's not what it once was.
A bit distressed, as yes. chapels go. Et le vitrail de Sainte-Amélie, the stained glass window of Sainte-Amélie.
Alors, il a été déposé parce que malheureusement la chapelle a connu un grand dégât des eaux.
So you took the window out because there was water damage in here. Yeah. Et c'était où le vitrail?
Il était vraiment situé à l'extrémité de la chapelle.
So it was the main window of the chapel, sort of the central window.
Et voici le vitrail de Sainte-Amélie.
Merci.
Gosh, it's in really bad condition, isn't it?
That's horrendous.
The stained glass window was removed back in 1970, and it's in a terrible state.
It's just so dark. Of course, what you need is to see the light behind
it. Yeah,
you
do.
Albon has arranged to stand the window up in the hope that we can see the design. A large piece of perspex is required to prevent the glass shattering. This window hasn't been moved for 46 years, and it's extremely fragile. We can hardly bear to watch.
Wow. What a difference of the light behind it.
Incredible.
Out of the darkness, de la Roche's design for Saint Amélie is lit up for the first time in nearly half a century.
That's just amazing, isn't it? When it was on the ground, it just looked dark, dingy, and it's just vibrant. It's amazing.
I mean, those colours, they're like jewels glowing from the glass. And this is so beautifully done, look at that. The figure of Saint Amélie is just exquisite. This painting, your painting, of course, we hope, was the source of this.
But does the stained glass window designed by de la Roche match up with Neil's painting?
I mean, there's obvious similarities, aren't there, which is encouraging. Yes. There's a few differences as well. The dress with the girl on the right. But it's green, it's not blue. Also, look at the cloth in the background.
Yeah. Her dress is beautiful. I know it's different to the picture, but the colours are wonderful.
And it is different, though, isn't it? Because the dress has obviously got all that red in it, mm-hmm. and this doesn't have any. I'm not quite sure what to make of that.
These differences could be cause for concern and need further investigation.
What we need to do next, I think, is find out more about how this was commissioned, and that might give us more evidence to show that your painting was what led to this glorious piece of stained glass.
Back in London, I'm focusing on the physical evidence. I'm hoping to unlock clues in the painting itself, so I'm taking it to the Courtauld Institute for forensic analysis. Aviva Bernstock is one of the world's leading authorities in the scientific study of art. Her research could provide vital evidence to prove whether Neil's painting is the lost de la Roche or a copy by another hand. One problem I need her to address is the size of the picture, which doesn't match up with the catalogue entry Bendel found. If this is the lost original, it should measure 42 by 28 centimetres.
We're out. It's 44 high and 29 across.
Mm-hmm. Well, hold on 1 minute. If you look closely at the picture, you can see that there's an unpainted edge at the top and also at the bottom and on the left. And this picture's been relined, you can tell that from the back.
So put onto a new canvas?
Yes, put onto a new canvas, and it's been restretched with the painted edge further in the picture plane. So the turnover edge is further in.
I see, yeah. Areas that were folded over have now become incorporated into the front.
That's exactly right.
If we measure then what you consider to be the original.
Okay. If we measure the painted edge to the painted edge, the height is exactly 42, and the width is exactly 28.
The dimensions of the lost picture. Aviva, you have solved a major problem here.
Back in France, we're trying to find out more about de la Roche's commission to paint Saint-Amélie. Becky and I have come to the world-famous Sèvres porcelain factory near Paris. Sèvres was known for creating the finest hand-painted porcelain. It still is today. But back in 1827, the craftsmen also turned their hand to creating grand decorative schemes in stained glass. Sèvres engaged some of the most admired artists of the day to create designs. And when King Louis-Philippe requested the window for the Queen's Chapel, he chose de la Roche for the job. We're looking for any evidence Neil's picture was de la Roche's original design for the Saint-Amélie window.
Now, in here, Becky, are the cartoons or drawings done by the artists here at Sèvres from original paintings to create the stained glass windows in the chateau. Of course, one of which came from the painting by de la Roche. I mean, they're absolutely beautiful, aren't they?
Exquisite.
So beautifully done. Now, what's this? Oh, hang on. Bingo. Oh,
there it is. That's definitely it, isn't it? And we can see all the detail now that we couldn't see yesterday.
Let's get your picture, put it there, and let's compare the two. What do you think?
Well, it's different, isn't it? So every time we see a version of this picture, it's different.
It is. I think that's encouraging, you know?
Yeah, it is.
I think it is encouraging, because if all the other versions look the same, and yours was the one that was different, I'd be worried.
Yeah.
And don't forget, this is stained glass, so I would imagine that the craftsmen here at Sèvres would have interpreted de la Roche's work and then done a version which maximised the impact of stained glass, because it's a completely different medium. It would have light shining through it.
Yeah.
It's difficult, isn't it, to come to any firm conclusion comparing your painting with this wonderful image in front of us, but it is yet another piece that was missing in the jigsaw puzzle.
Back at the Courtauld Institute, Aviva is using imaging techniques to reveal clues hidden within Neil's painting. In the past, experts have dismissed the picture as a copy, possibly because the print reproduced from the lost de la Roche appears more detailed than Neil's painting in places. For instance, on the plant pot, in the curtain in the background, and on the face of one of the girls. I'm hoping that Aviva's analysis can explain some of those differences. First, we're looking at an ultraviolet image, which can show where later layers of paint have been added.
One's eye is immediately taken to those rather sort of vicious-looking scars in the background.
Yeah, you can see that the painting has been torn, and it shows very clearly some of the areas of damage and repaint that have been put on in restoration campaigns.
And it's homing in on specific areas. So, for example, what about the pot?
Yes, in fact, you can see those blotchy-looking marks that look quite dark blue, which I suspect are not original. There's definitely a great deal of overpainting in that area of the picture.
That's reassuring. So let's look at other parts of the painting. Now, the curtain in the engraving is evidently decorated. Ours is blank. Mm. Now, can that be explained by this new image?
Well, the background paint over the brocade cloth is the most dense area of overpainting. You can see that this dark area completely solidly covers what's underneath.
So is there anywhere else in the picture you think is worth pointing out?
Well, there is a big area here of overpaint on the face. You can see the sort of spidery cracks on the face itself and the hair.
So behind this brick wall of overpaint might lie something that's closer to the engraving.
Yes, it well might.
This is encouraging, but I'm also keen to see whether an infrared image can reveal evidence of a master at work or a mere copyist. Are there any clues, changes of mind, that suggest the artist is working out the composition as he goes along?
I always love changes of mind. It shows that there's some creative process going on, that some thought is taking place. Because, of course, you wouldn't necessarily expect to find those in a copyist.
Well, actually, we can see quite a few changes. For example, there's this area here in the background. It looks, it's underpainted very dark colour, which now is a watery area of the background landscape. And then perhaps the most striking of all is in the hands of the left-hand figure. I think you can see here, this is the hands as painted.
Yeah.
And this look like they are where the hands are in a different position.
Brilliant. So what we're seeing is creation in action rather than some laborious, slavish copy.
Yes.
Whoever painted this picture was altering their ideas as they moved along. And we know that Delaroche, this is the testament of his students, used to do this himself sometimes. Could it be that this is what we're seeing here?
Back in France, we're on the trail of the lost Delaroche. I've been trying to find out where it went after the work was completed in 1832. The heavens have opened, and we've taken refuge inside so I can tell Becky about a stormy period in the painting's past.
There's a reason I brought you here to the Tuileries Garden, bang smack in the centre of Paris. So I've been looking through all the archives I can find from that period to see what did happen to that Delaroche painting, hopefully your painting, after 1832.
Yeah.
I found a magazine here that I think you'll think is rather interesting. It's dated September 1837. It's called Revue Britannique. Now, there's a reference here talking about the painting of Mr. Delaroche, painted for the Queen of the French, in which decorates now, that is September 1837, the chapel at the Tuileries.
OK.
And what that's referring to is this, the Palace of the Tuileries. So you can see it was a very grand affair, which was just out there.
The Tuileries Palace no longer stands today. It was burned down in the late 19th century. But during the reign of King Louis-Philippe and Queen Marie-Amélie, it was their main residence and home to Delaroche's lost work.
She had the stained glass window of St. Amélie in her summer chapel at Eure, and in her main chapel here at the Tuileries, she had Delaroche's painting. And she would kneel before it and pray before it.
Yeah. Well, it must have been very special for her.
And hopefully, that's your painting.
Yeah.
Queen Marie-Amélie and King Louis-Philippe lived at the Tuileries for another decade, until their reign came to an abrupt end. On the 24th of February, 1848, an angry mob descended on the palace, baying for their blood. Terrified, they tried to escape, but the mob had stormed the gates, burnt the carriages, and killed the stable hands. In disguise, they managed to flee for their lives.
The horses take them away, they escape the mob, they go all the way to the coast and make safe passage to England. And that was the end of the monarchy in France.
Gosh.
So your painting, if it is indeed by Delaroche, witnessed some of the most dramatic events in French history.
Wow. So obviously they didn't take the picture with them?
By all accounts, and from what the king himself said in his diaries, they took nothing but what they were standing up in. But the question is...
Yeah, what happened to it after that?
That's what we need to find next.
We're hot on the trail of Queen Marie-Amélie and King Louis-Philippe on their desperate flight from France to exile in England. They travelled from Dover incognito under the name Mr. and Mrs. Lebrun. For fear of assassination, the king had shaved off his whiskers and removed his wig. Their loyal friend Queen Victoria came to the rescue, offering them refuge at one of her favourite houses, Claremont in Surrey. This grand Palladian mansion is now a school, but in 1848 it was sanctuary to the exiled royal family. They arrived here with nothing. The new French government forbade them access to any of their money, property, or possessions. But eventually, some of their belongings were returned to them.
Something I'd like to show you this way.
We're meeting Bendor, who's been trying to find out where the Queen's prized de la Roche ended up in all the upheaval.
This was Mary Amelie's bedroom from the time of her exile, when she lived here from 1848. And quite a nice room for a bedroom, don't you think?
It certainly is.
And sadly, I haven't been able to find an inventory of exactly what works of art Mary Amelie was allowed to take away from France. However, I have got a painting here that was sold by her descendants very recently in 2015. It's a painting by the English watercolourist Joseph Nash, who was renowned for doing very detailed interiors of rooms in very plush houses like this. And in 1866, which is that's 150 years ago, Joseph Nash came to this room and he stood around about here, and this is what he saw. And I think you'll find it very interesting.
Where is it?
Not there.
Bingo.
Wow.
So it was hanging just behind that door there.
Oh my goodness.
There on the wall, right beside Mary Amelie's bed, is the only image of the Queen's lost de la Roche that's known to exist.
Well, I think that's fantastic, isn't it? It's just to see it there.
As soon as you said Nash, I thought, yes, there's going to be a picture of the room. And sure enough, there it is.
Nash, bless him for us, stood here and was meticulous about recording everything he saw.
Now, do we think it looks like your painting, Becky? That's the question. On close inspection, I think it does.
Yeah, I think it does. All the versions we've seen have been different, but this one looks the closest to our picture.
It's the next best thing we can get to a photograph.
Gosh, how exciting.
Yeah. Don't you think, Becky, it's lovely to see what a treasured item this picture once was to the Queen of France?
Yeah. I mean, it's in a real prominent position in her room, isn't it?
She prayed in front of it. It was tremendously important to her.
The painting must have been a great comfort to the Queen, who'd lost her crown, her country, and she would soon lose her king. 2 years into their exile, Louis-Philippe passed away at Claremont. Mary Amelie spent her remaining years in mourning and died in 1866, the year Nash painted her room.
It's possible that her family or someone asked Nash to record the bedroom after she died for posterity.
Well, the thing is, Becky, one of the great mysteries of many about your painting is we know it started off in France. How did it end up in Britain?
Yeah.
Well, now we know how certainly the original de la Roche ended up in Britain, which makes it just that smidge more likely that it could be yours.
Yeah, I think so too. I mean, I think up to this point, there's been quite a lot of doubt because there were so many different versions. But this is probably the first time I'm thinking maybe it really could be the thing, you know. I think it's the closest we've got so far, isn't it? It's amazing.
That was so exciting. And for Becky, it was a real turning point. She now believes that Neil's painting could be the genuine de la Roche. What we still don't know, though, is Neil's painting the one that we saw in that Nash watercolour? We still can't be sure about that. Neil's could be a copy. We've still got work to do on that score.
De la Roche was painting at a time when it was standard practice for copies to be made of his works by students or artists in his circle. But were any made of St. Amelie? I've come to France on a mission to hunt them down. If I can identify all the replicas that were painted, hopefully I can rule out Neil's painting as one of them. I've come to Prignac in Bordeaux, to the church of Saint-Pierre. I've been given a tip-off. There's a copy of St. Amelie hanging here.
This is St. Amelie, this is it. This is our image, but expanded 50 or 60 times. So this was done in 1844, 12 years after the painting by Delaroche. And it was an official copy, something done with the permission of the king and queen themselves. And it's by an artist called Leontine Tacussel. Even though it's been heavily restored, I think you can tell there are definite weaknesses when you compare it to ours. I don't think the faces are anything like as fine. It's almost as if they've been inflated with a bicycle pump. And actually, it's a not dissimilar story in the landscape behind. Here it looks a bit like a sort of theatrical backdrop. It's not as convincing.
It's reassuring to see that Neil's picture is much more finely painted than this copy. This is what you'd expect if it's the original Delaroche. But I may be judging unfairly. The copy recently underwent extensive restoration, and to make some proper comparisons, I really need to see an image of the picture before work took place. Stephanie Richard from the local Heritage Association has agreed to meet me to share what she knows.
Stephanie, bonjour, comment ça va?
Bonjour, très bien, et vous?
Très bien, merci.
This is what the painting looked like before restoration.
Uh-huh. That's of some concern. There are distinct differences in the colouring when you compare it to ours. I mean, look at the figure in the far right. In our picture, she's got a blue dress. Here, she's green. And then the kneeling figure in the middle of the three, the dress is yellow. In ours, it's distinctly white.
But the most troubling difference is the dress of St. Amelie herself. On Neil's painting, it's gold, but on the copy, it's golden red. If this is a faithful replica of the original, we're in trouble.
Now, what we really need to know is, could Leontine Tacussel have had access to the original Paul Delaroche picture?
Yes, this is a letter that informs us that Leontine Tacussel had access to the original painting of Paul Delaroche.
That's a problem. Is there anything else you managed to establish?
Yes. We have also another letter from Leontine Tacussel, and we learned that another artist, Madame Gamin du Pasquier, made another copy of Paul Delaroche.
So hang on. We've now got another copy out there.
Yeah, but smaller than Leontine Tacussel.
Do you know where it is?
No.
This is a troubling development. There's a possibility that this rogue St. Amelie copy could be Neil's picture.
That conversation with Stephanie was both worrying and frankly completely unexpected. So now we know that out there somewhere, don't know where it is another copy of this composition by this artist called Gamin du Pasquier. I mean, it's imperative that we try and find this picture and establish that it's not our picture.
Back at the gallery, Bendall is trying to track down this suspect copy so we can eliminate it from our inquiries. And his research has brought several other versions out of the shadows. We're joining him to inspect a lineup of all known copies of St. Amelie.
Hi, Bendall, how are you getting on?
Taken a bit of digging, but I managed to track down the lost Amelie copy to northern France. It's in a church in a town called Mortigny. And the thing is, it's big. It's over 2 meters tall. So we can definitely rule out the possibility that Neil's picture was the copy by Gamin du Pasquier.
That's a huge relief, isn't it? I mean, that was getting a real worry.
But there is, however, one other copy that I'm afraid I haven't been able to track down yet. There's a passing reference to it in this letter by an artist called Jerome, writing in 1847. And he mentions that he's finishing a copy of St. Amelie. Now, there's no dimensions here. We don't even know if it was finished.
But then it's a possibility that Neil's painting is that Jerome copy.
It is a possibility. But I think we can cautiously assume that Jerome's copy, like the other painter copies, would be big.
And it does make sense, doesn't it? If the Queen is sanctioning these images, these paintings of her namesake, they're going to have some sort of propaganda function. They're going to be big. They're going to put over the message.
The only thing is, seeing these two church paintings now side by side for the first time, they look very similar, particularly when it comes to the colours. But they don't look similar to Neil's.
Yeah, if Neil's is going to be the lost picture, we have to work out why on earth the colours are different from what we know the known copies are. And the only thing that's going to help us with that, I suspect at this stage, is forensics. Mm. So how far have you got tracking where the lost De La Roche went?
Not very good, I'm afraid. Only up to Mary Emily's death in 1866.
And then we've got this huge gap between then and when it emerges on the market, when Neil buys the painting in the 1980s. And I have to say, I don't like that gap at all. We've nothing there.
I need to find out what happened to Queen Mary Amélie's art collection after her death in 1866. So I've returned to France. I'm heading to the National Archives in Paris. The papers of the French royal family are held here. It's the largest private archive in Europe, amounting to 40 tons of documents. I'm hoping Mary Amélie's will can shed some light on where her treasured De La Roche ended up.
So we've got Queen Mary Amélie will diamonds portraits, Queen Mary Amélie notes silver paintings. So let's look in here. I mean, this is fascinating to be able to peer into her life in this way. It's a list of all the silver at Clermont. It's a long list here of all her porcelain. Ah, paintings. Here we go, right at the top of the list. Sainte-Amélie de la Roche. Brilliant. And actually, it's also the most valuable. £1,200. And that's saying something because there's a Van Dyck in here. And that's worth less. So at the top of the list and the most valuable in her will is the Sainte-Amélie by De La Roche. But it doesn't say who she left it to.
A search through another file reveals a list made by Mary Amélie's son, the Duc de Nemours, requesting certain objects that had belonged to his mother.
Oh, here we go, here we go. La Sainte-Amélie de La Roche. So it looks like, therefore, the painting that she loved so much went to her son. To the Duc de Nemours.
The Duc de Nemours lived at Bushy House in Twickenham, so we can assume Saint Amélie hung there. But where did it go after his death in 1896?
Well, this is the will of the Duc de Nemours. And in it, he says that he leaves all his paintings to his son, and then says, and there is a list of those paintings in amongst his papers. But incredibly frustratingly, in all this paperwork about the Duc de Nemours, that list of his paintings isn't here. So the trail stops here.
The Provenance trail may have come to a halt, but back at the Courtauld Institute, I'm hoping science might provide some answers to the last hurdle concerning the colours in Neil's picture.
So, Aviva, we have a rather alarming issue. Some of the colours in our painting don't match the colours of the copies in the French churches. And one of the particular areas of concern is the dress of St. Amélie. In the copies, it's red and gold. In ours, it's just gold.
Well, actually, I've looked at that area quite closely, and you can see here a red paint has been applied, which covered the golden paint in a decorative pattern. And in those areas, the paint has faded.
There's no doubt about it. It's gone a bit murky, but that's unquestionably a red now you pointed out.
It is. It's red. Some of these red pigments that were used in the 19th century faded more than others, and this one looks like a natural dye which has faded in the light.
So this dress was definitely patterned red?
It was definitely patterned red, yes.
Well, OK, this is great, but I've got something even more tricky, and that is the dress of the kneeling figure. Now, in our painting, it is unquestionably blue, but in the copies, it's green.
Well, I've looked at that area too, so it does look very blue. But if you look at the very edge, can you see that there's a green area, a green line at the edge of the drapery?
Yeah, I can. There's a little flash of emerald green. Yeah.
So I couldn't really tell what the pigments were under the microscope, so I took a sample. And what you can see is the blue pigment,
was mixed with this other pigment, which now looks white. You see these groups of white particles, which were probably yellow originally. So what you had was a yellow that faded.
So the yellow, added with the blue, that made it green, has disappeared, turning it back to blue.
Yes, that's exactly right.
OK, but there's another clothes issue, mm-hmm. and that's the other kneeling figure. Now, in the copies, her dress is clearly yellow, particularly the sort of skirt area beneath. But in our painting, it's white.
Mm-hmm. Well, this area, interestingly, has been overpainted. And you see that gritty paint, which was applied over an underlying layer?
Yeah, it's very clear. Yeah. It's sort of opaque and granular, isn't it?
You see it's everywhere, covering up another colour underneath.
So we have got paint that has been applied on top, which unquestionably would explain a change.
That's true.
Based on Aviva's scientific findings, we can now reconstruct what the picture might have looked like before the colours changed. For me, all nagging doubts have at last been ironed out, and Delaroche is still firmly in the frame. We've done all that we can, but is it enough to convince the world authority on Delaroche? Professor Stephen Bann is the leading expert, having lectured and published on the artist for over 30 years. We've invited him to the Courtauld Institute so he can examine Neil's painting. When the art market needs to authenticate a potential work by Delaroche, Professor Bann is the expert they consult.
Get that sick sort of exam feel, don't you? How do you do?
Nice to meet you.
And you.
Nice to meet you.
We're going to give him some time to evaluate our evidence and decide whether Neil's painting is a genuine work by Paul Delaroche or not.
When we started this investigation, there were some troubling concerns with Neil's picture, but rather wonderfully, science has explained them all. There's the problem with the engraving. It seemed that the Mercury print showed things that weren't in our picture. We've explained that. It's overpaint. Then there was the colour changes, as indicated by the copies. But we now know that the pigments have degraded. And then there's the artist's changes of mind. The art world loves those. I think we've proved that this is by Paul Delaroche. But can we convince the authority?
It's always such an anxious time when the painting is being scrutinised like this. And I think we've taken Delaroche's lost painting right back to the beginning. We know why it was commissioned by the last king of the French, Louis-Philippe, as an act of love for his wife. That magnificent stained glass window was the result. Then in the tumult of the revolution, when Louis-Philippe and Marie-Amélie fled for their lives to England, the painting followed. And then she bequeathed it to her son, but that's where the trail goes cold. Between 1896, when he died, and the 1980s, when the painting resurfaced for sale here in England, where was it? I don't like that kind of vacuum, and neither does the art world. I hope we've done enough.
A week has passed, and Becky is on her way to the gallery. We're all about to discover whether Neil's painting has been accepted as a genuine work by Paul Delaroche.
Hi, Becky.
Hi, Fiona.
Hi, Philip.
How are you feeling?
A bit nervous, a bit apprehensive.
If Professor Bann says that this is a work by Paul Delaroche, it's worth £50,000.
Becky, Neil paid how much for it?
£500.
Oh, so that's a massive difference. But it's not just about the money, is it, Becky? I mean, this is Neil's painting. It was his vision, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, he really believed it was a Delaroche. So if we can prove it is a Delaroche, it would be something very special.
We're about to find out. Professor Stephen Bann is heading to the gallery to give us his verdict.
Hello, Professor.
How do you do?
You've come to a verdict, I assume.
I have. I've reviewed all the evidence and I've reached my decision. In my opinion, this is definitely the lost Sainte-Amélie by Paul Delaroche.
How marvellous.
That's fantastic.
Oh, what a relief.
Really? Oh my goodness, I'm slightly tearful.
Oh, that's just... Oh my God, Becky,
I know, my God.
Oh, that's just amazing. I'm just so pleased because Neil was sure that it was a Delaroche. It's just, it's fantastic.
I wasn't sure we were going to make it, Becky, you know, I have to say, at one point.
I know, there were some, definitely there were points when I didn't think it was the real thing, but Neil did, so I'm so pleased.
So Neil was right about his Delaroche all along, and a royal treasure lost for over 100 years has at last been found. But what swung it for Professor Ban?
There were several factors which influenced me. The extraordinarily impressive work done to trace the different incarnations of Saint-Emilie. The scientific evidence, which I found extremely convincing. And I found a letter which strongly supports all the work that had been done.
Really?
Stephen has an 11th hour revelation. A letter written by Delaroche in 1832, soon after he'd completed his Saint-Amélie.
He's just visited the stained glass workshop and he's found that his painting is in a pitiable state. He says, the damage is considerable and obliges me to undertake a long and tedious task. I'm going to try and repair the damage, but I will no longer take responsibility for a new accident.
That's fantastic, because it shows that the restoration that we picked up on this picture is actually partly, if not largely, by the artist himself.
Yes, indeed. There will have been further restorations later on, but certainly it's true that Paul Delaroche must have done a considerable amount.
Does that affect the value of it at all?
Yes, I mean, in commercial terms, now that we know that a large part of those additions are by the artist himself, it becomes a much purer historical artifact. And I can now see it pushing up to £75,000.
It's a lot of money.
This is a much-needed result for a family who've had a rough few years.
The whole thing's been a bit of a roller coaster right from the start, thinking it isn't, but I'm so pleased that it is the real thing. The boys will be so excited. They'll be jumping around the kitchen, so, you know, they'll just be chuffed.
What a result! We found a lost royal treasure.
And now we've proven Neil right.
If you think you might have an undiscovered masterpiece, we'd love to hear from you at bbc.co.uk/fakeorfortune.
That's just amazing, isn't it? When it was on the ground, it just looked dark, dingy, and it's just vibrant. It's amazing.
I mean, those colours, they're like jewels glowing from the glass. And this is so beautifully done, look at that. The figure of Saint Amélie is just exquisite. This painting, your painting, of course, we hope, was the source of this.
But does the stained glass window designed by Delaroche match up with Neil's painting?
I mean, there's obvious similarities, aren't there, which is encouraging. Yes. There's a few differences as well. The dress with the girl on the right. But it's green, it's not blue. Also, look at the cloth in the background.
Yeah. Her dress is beautiful. I know it's different to the picture, but the colours are wonderful.
And it is different, though, isn't it? Because the dress has obviously got all that red in it. Mm-hmm. And this doesn't have any. I'm not quite sure what to make of that.
These differences could be cause for concern and need further investigation.
What we need to do next, I think, is find out more about how this was commissioned, and that might give us more evidence to show that your painting was what led to this glorious piece of stained glass.
Back in London, I'm focusing on the physical evidence. I'm hoping to unlock clues in the painting itself. So I'm taking it to the Courtauld Institute for forensic analysis. Aviva Bernstock is one of the world's leading authorities in the scientific study of art. Her research could provide vital evidence to prove whether Neil's painting is the lost Delaroche or a copy by another hand. One problem I need her to address is the size of the picture, which doesn't match up with the catalogue entry Bendel found. If this is the lost original, it should measure 42 by 28 centimetres.
We're out. It's 44 high and 29 across.
Mm-hmm. Well, hold on 1 minute. If you look closely at the picture, you can see that there's an unpainted edge at the top and also at the bottom and on the left. And this picture's been relined, you can tell that from the back.
So put onto a new canvas?
Yes, put onto a new canvas, and it's been restretched with the painted edge further in the picture plane. So the turnover edge is further in.
I see, yeah. Areas that were folded over have now become incorporated into the front.
That's exactly right.
If we measure then what you consider to be the original.
Okay. If we measure the painted edge to the painted edge, the height is exactly 42, and the width is exactly 28.
Delaroche. So if we can prove it, it would be something very special.
We're called to the far corners of the country to help viewers investigate their mysterious works of art. This case brings us north of the border to Aberdeenshire and the beautiful county of Banff. We've been contacted by a family who think there might be a missing masterpiece hanging in their B&B. And what a B&B it is. This is Castle of Park, built in the 16th century. Many a laird has lived here over the past 500 years, but it's now home to the Wilson family and their guests.
Hiya. Who are you?
I'm Archie.
Archie, nice to meet you.
How do you do, Archie?
Hiya, Fiona, hi. Hi. Hi there, hi.
Hi,
Becky.
Hi.
Yes,
hi.
Nice
how
to
are
see you.
You.
Very
hi,
nice
how
to
do
meet
you.
You yeah, thank you.
The Wilsons moved here in 2007, and Becky has worked hard to restore the castle, filling the rooms with antiques and hanging the walls with art.
All these gorgeous paintings on the wall.
And here's Neil's painting.
Becky has asked us here to see a mysterious picture owned by her late husband, who was an art dealer.
Oh, a portrait of a kneeling medieval queen, it looks like.
Absolutely beautiful, Becky. I can see why your husband loved it so much. And what do you know about it?
I don't know a lot. I know he bought it when he left university, when he was working at Christie's. This was one of the first pictures he bought there.
And when was that?
It's in 1989. And he bought it for about £500. It's not signed. It wasn't attributed to anybody. He just liked it because it was a beautiful picture.
So it was just an anonymous painting?
Yes, absolutely. It was only later, after he'd been working, you know, a lot longer in the art world, that he had a hunch that it was painted by Delaroche.
So by Paul Delaroche, the great early 19th century French history painter. I mean, a name to conjure with.
Paul Delaroche was a phenomenon in his day. Born in 1797, he made his name in Paris in the 1820s and 30s, painting famous scenes from history and religion. Joan of Arc in prison, the death of Elizabeth I, the princes in the tower. Delaroche's potent mix of high drama and human emotion made his works hugely. Bonnard's trail may have come to a halt, but back at the Courtauld Institute, I'm hoping science might provide some answers to the last hurdle concerning the colours in Neil's picture.
So, Aviva, we have a rather alarming issue. Some of the colours in our painting don't match the colours of the copies in the French churches. And one of the particular areas of concern is the dress of St. Amelie. In the copies, it's red and gold. In ours, it's just gold.
Well, actually, I've looked at that area quite closely, and you can see here a red paint has been applied, which covered the golden paint in a decorative pattern. And in those areas, the paint has faded.
There's no doubt about it. It's gone a bit murky, but that's unquestionably a red now you pointed out.
It is. It's red. Some of these red pigments that were used in the 19th century faded more than others, and this one looks like a natural dye which has faded in the light.
So this dress was definitely patterned red?
It was definitely patterned red, yes.
Well, OK, this is great, but I've got something even more tricky, and that is the dress of the kneeling figure. Now, in our painting, it is unquestionably blue, but in the copies, it's green.
Well, I've looked at that area too, so it does look very blue. But if you look at the very edge, can you see that there's a green area, a green line at the edge of the drapery?
Yeah, I can. There's a little flash of emerald green. Yeah.
So I couldn't really tell what the pigments were under the microscope, so I took a sample. And what you can see is the blue pigment was mixed with this other pigment, which now looks white. You see these groups of white particles, which were probably yellow originally. So what you had was a yellow that faded.
So the yellow added with the blue that made it green has disappeared, turning it back to blue.
Yes, that's exactly right.
OK, but there's another clothes issue, mm-hmm. and that's the other kneeling figure. Now, in the copies, her dress is clearly yellow, particularly the sort of skirt area beneath. But in our painting, it's white.
Mm-hmm. Well, this area, interestingly, has been overpainted. And you see that gritty paint, which was applied over an underlying layer?
Yeah, it's very clear. It's sort of opaque and granular, isn't it?
You see, it's everywhere, covering up another colour underneath.
So we have got paint that has been applied on top, which unquestionably would explain a change.
That's true.
Based on Aviva's scientific findings, we can now reconstruct what the picture might have looked like before the colours changed. For me, all nagging doubts have at last been ironed out, and Delaroche is still firmly in the frame. We've done all that we can, but is it enough to convince the world authority on Delaroche? Professor Stephen Bann is the leading expert, having lectured and worked by Paul Delaroche, or not.
When we started this investigation, there were some troubling concerns with Neil's picture, but rather wonderfully, science has explained them all. There's the problem with the engraving. It seemed that the Mercury print showed things that weren't in our picture. We've explained that. It's overpaint. Then there was the colour changes, as indicated by the copies. But we now know that the pigments have degraded. And then there's the artist's changes of mind. The art world loves those. I think we've proved that this is by Paul Delaroche. But can we convince the authority?
It's always such an anxious time when the painting is being scrutinised like this. And I think we've taken Delaroche's lost painting right back to the beginning. We know why it was commissioned by the last king of the French, Louis-Philippe, as an act of love for his wife. That magnificent stained glass window was the result. Then in the tumult of the revolution, when Louis-Philippe and Marie-Amélie fled for their lives to England, the painting followed. And then she bequeathed it to her son, but that's where the trail goes cold. Between 1896, when he died, and the 1980s, when the painting resurfaced for sale here in England, where was it? I don't like that kind of vacuum, and neither does the art world. I hope we've done enough. A week has passed, and Becky is on her way to the gallery. We're all about to discover whether Neil's painting has been accepted as a genuine work by Paul Delaroche. Hi, Becky.
Hi, Fiona.
Hi, Philip.
How are you feeling?
A bit nervous, a bit apprehensive.
If Professor Bann says that this is a work by Paul Delaroche, it's worth £50,000.
Becky, Neil paid how much for it?
£500.
Oh, so that's a massive difference. But it's not just about the money, is it, Becky? I mean, this is Neil's painting. It was his vision, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, he really believed it was a Delaroche. So if we can prove it is a Delaroche, it would be something very special.
We're about to find out. Professor Stephen Bann is heading to the gallery to give us his verdict.
Hello, Professor.
How do you do?
You've come to a verdict, I assume.
I have. I've reviewed all the evidence and I've reached my decision. In my opinion, this is definitely the lost Sainte-Amélie by Paul de la Roche.
I love this.
That's fantastic.
Oh, what a relief.
Really? Oh my goodness, I'm slightly tearful. Oh, that's just... Oh my God, Becky, what are you thinking?
Oh my gosh. Oh, that's just amazing.
I'm just so pleased because Neil was dramatic events in French history.
Wow.
So obviously they didn't take the picture with them.
By all accounts, and from what the king himself said in his diaries, they took nothing but what they were standing up in. But the question is...
Yeah, what happened to it after that?
That's what we need to find next.
We're hot on the trail of Queen Marie-Amélie and King Louis-Philippe on their desperate flight from France to exile in England. They travelled from Dover incognito under the name Mr. and Mrs. Lebrun. For fear of assassination, the king had shaved off his whiskers and removed his wig. Their loyal friend Queen Victoria came to the rescue, offering them refuge at one of her favourite houses, Claremont in Surrey. This grand Palladian mansion is now a school, but in 1848 it was sanctuary to the exiled royal family. They arrived here with nothing. The new French government forbade them access to any of their money, property, or possessions. But eventually, some of their belongings were returned to them.
Something I'd like to show you this way.
We're meeting Bendor, who's been trying to find out where the Queen's prized de la Roche ended up in all the upheaval.
This was Marie-Amélie's bedroom from the time of her exile, when she lived here from 1848. And quite a nice room for a bedroom, don't you think?
It certainly is.
And sadly, I haven't been able to find an inventory of exactly what works of art Marie-Amélie was allowed to take away from France. However, I have got a painting here that was sold by her descendants very recently in 2015. It's a painting by the English watercolourist Joseph Nash, who was renowned for doing very detailed interiors of rooms in very plush houses like this. And in 1866, which is that's 150 years ago, Joseph Nash came to this room and he stood around about here, and this is what he saw. And I think you'll find it very interesting.
Where is it?
Not there.
Bingo.
Wow.
So it was hanging just behind that door there.
Oh my goodness.
There on the wall, right beside Marie-Amélie's bed, is the only image of the Queen's lost de la Roche that's known to exist.
Well, I think that's fantastic, isn't it? It's just to see it there.
As soon as you said Nash, I thought, yes, there's going to be a picture of the room. And sure enough, there it is.
Nash, bless him for us, stood here and was meticulous.
Dears, as they moved along. And we know that de la Roche, this is the testament of his students, used to do this himself sometimes. Could it be that this is what we're seeing here?
Back in France, we're on the trail of the lost de la Roche. I've been trying to find out where it went after the work was completed in 1832. The heavens have opened, and we've taken refuge inside so I can tell Becky about a stormy period in the painting's past.
There's a reason I brought you here to the Tuileries Garden, bang smack in the centre of Paris. So I've been looking through all the archives I can find from that period to see what did happen to that de la Roche painting, hopefully your painting, after 1832.
Yeah.
I found a magazine here that I think you'll think is rather interesting. It's dated September 1837. It's called Revue Britannique. Now, there's a reference here talking about the painting of Mr. de la Roche, painted for the Queen of the French, and which decorates now, that is September 1837, the chapel at the Tuileries.
Okay.
And what that's referring to is this. The Palace of the Tuileries. So you can see it was a very grand affair,
which was just out there.
The Tuileries Palace no longer stands today. It was burned down in the late 19th century. But during the reign of King Louis-Philippe and Queen Marie-Amélie, it was their main residence and home to Delaroche's lost work.
She had the stained glass window of St. Amélie in her summer chapel at Ur, and in her main chapel here at the Tuileries, she had Delaroche's painting. And she would kneel before it and pray before it.
Yeah. Well, it must have been very special for her.
And hopefully, that's your painting.
Queen Marie-Amélie and King Louis-Philippe lived at the Tuileries for another decade, until their reign came to an abrupt end. On the 24th of February, 1848, an angry mob descended on the palace, baying for their blood. Terrified, they tried to escape, but the mob had stormed the gates, burnt the carriages, and killed the stable hands. In disguise, they managed to flee for their lives.
The horses take them away, they escape the mob, they go all the way to the coast and make safe passage to England. And that was the end of the monarchy in France.
Gosh.
So your painting, if it is indeed by Delaroche, witnessed some of the most dramatic events in French history.
Wow. So obviously they didn't take the picture with them?
By all accounts, and from what the king himself said in his diaries, they took nothing but what they were standing up in. But the question is...
Yeah, what happened to it after that?
That's what we need to find next.
But it's now home to the Wilson family and their guests.
Hiya. Who are you?
I'm Archie.
Archie, nice to meet you.
How do you do, Archie?
Hiya, Fiona, hi. Hi. Hi there, hi.
Hi.
Becky,
hi.
Yes,
hi.
Nice
how
to
are
see you.
You.
Hello,
very nice
how
to
do
meet
you.
Yeah, thank you.
The Wilsons moved here in 2007, and Becky has worked hard to restore the castle, filling the rooms with antiques and hanging the walls with art.
All these gorgeous paintings on the wall.
And here's Neil's painting.
Becky has asked us here to see a mysterious picture owned by her late husband, who was an art dealer.
Oh, a portrait of a kneeling medieval queen, it looks like.
Absolutely beautiful, Becky. I can see why your husband loved it so yeah. much.
And what do you know about it?
I don't know a lot. I know he bought it when he left university, when he was working at Christie's. This was one of the first pictures he bought there.
And when was that?
It's in 1989, and he bought it for about £500. It's not signed. It wasn't attributed to anybody. He just liked it because it was a beautiful picture.
So it was just an anonymous painting?
Yes, absolutely. It was only later, after he'd been working, you know, a lot longer in the art world, that he had a hunch that it was painted by Delaroche.
So by Paul Delaroche, the great early 19th century French history painter. I mean, a name to conjure with.
Paul Delaroche was a phenomenon in his day. Born in 1797, he made his name in Paris in the 1820s and 30s, painting famous scenes from history and religion. Joan of Arc in prison, the death of Elizabeth I, the princes in the tower. Delaroche's potent mix of high drama and human emotion made his works hugely popular. And thanks to the production of prints copied from his paintings, he became a household name across Europe and beyond. But after his death in 1856, tastes changed and his work fell out of fashion. Now Delaroche is making a comeback, which means if this is a lost work, it has currency.
So Neil bought it in 1989 for £500. So if it is a genuine Delaroche, Philip, what would it be worth?
Well, given that it's a really entrancing image, and I think that's going to make a big difference, if it is a genuine work by him, I can see it being worth £50,000.
Wow. That would be a heck of a return on his
yeah,
investment, wouldn't it?
It would, yeah.
So he must have been pretty excited about it, Becky. Did he get anyone else to look at it?
Yes, there was a Delaroche exhibition at the National Gallery in 2010. So he took it down to the National Gallery, but the experts were not us.
We use old-fashioned detective work and state-of-the-art science to get to the truth.
Science can enable us to see beyond the human eye.
Ta-da!
Oh, wow!
The problem is, not every painting is quite what it seems.
You successfully faked Lowry's, even while you were at school, didn't you?
Yes.
It's a journey that can end in joy.
Oh, dear.
Isn't that great?
It's wonderful.
or bitter disappointment.
I can't cope with this roller coaster. What a nightmare.
In this episode, could a painting hanging in a Scottish castle be a work by 19th century French master Paul Delaroche?
Oh my goodness, that looks nearly identical.
A £500 picture might be a lost royal treasure.
Not just a painting with a provenance, but a fantastically gilded, elevated one.
Our investigation takes us to a French chateau in search of a cherished gift from a king to his queen.
Wow.
We're led on a turbulent trail through revolution and bloodshed.
So your painting, if it is by Delaroche, witnessed some of the most dramatic events in French history.
This is St. Amélie, this is it.
But will we do enough to help one woman in her quest to prove her late husband was right?
I mean, he really believed it was a Delaroche. So if we can prove it, it would be something very special.
Called to the far corners of the country to help viewers investigate their mysterious works of art. This case brings us north of the border to Aberdeenshire and the beautiful county of Banff. We've been contacted by a family who think there might be a missing masterpiece hanging in their B&B. And what a B&B it is. This is Castle of Park, built in the 16th century. Many a laird has lived here over the past 500 years, but it's now home to the Wilson family and their guests.
Hiya. Who are you?
I'm Archie.
Archie, nice to meet you.
How do you do, Archie?
Hiya, Fiona, hi. Hi. Hi there, hi.
Hi.
Becky,
hi.
Yes,
hi.
Nice
how
to see you.
Hello,
nice
how
to meet
do you?
You
want to
come in? Yeah, thank you.
The Wilsons moved here in 2007, and Becky has worked hard to restore the castle, filling the rooms with antiques and hanging the walls with art.
All these gorgeous.
Having lectured and published on the artist for over 30 years, we've invited him to the Courtauld Institute so he can examine Neil's painting. When the art market needs to authenticate a potential work by Delaroche, Professor Bann is the expert they consult.
Look at that sick sort of exam field, don't you? How do you do?
Nice to meet you.
And you.
Nice to meet you.
We're going to give him some time to evaluate our evidence and decide whether Neil's painting is a genuine work by Paul Delaroche or not.
When we started this investigation, there were some troubling concerns with Neil's picture, but rather wonderfully, science has explained them all. There's the problem with the engraving. It seemed that the Mercury print showed things that weren't in our picture. We've explained that. It's overpaint. Then there was the colour changes, as indicated by the copies, but we now know that the pigments have degraded. And then there's the artist's changes of mind. The art world loves those. I think we've proved that this is by Paul Delaroche, but can we convince the authority?
It's always such an anxious time when the painting is being scrutinized like this. And I think we've taken Delaroche's lost painting right back to the beginning. We know why it was commissioned by the last king of the French, Louis-Philippe, as an act of love for his wife. That magnificent stained glass window was the result. Then in the tumult of the revolution when Louis-Philippe and Marie-Amélie fled for their lives to England, the painting followed. And then she bequeathed it to her son, but that's where the trail goes cold. Between 1896, when he died, and the 1980s, when the painting resurfaced for sale here in England, where was it? I don't like that kind of vacuum, and neither does the art world. I hope we've done enough. A week has passed, and Becky is on her way to the gallery. We're all about to discover whether Neil's painting has been accepted as a genuine work by Paul Delaroche.
Hi, Becky.
Hi, Fiona.
Hi, Philip.
How are you feeling?
A bit nervous, a bit apprehensive.
If Professor Band says that this is a work by Paul Delaroche, it's worth £50,000.
Becky Neal paid how much for it?
£500.
Oh, so that's a massive difference. But it's not just about the money, is it, Becky? I mean, this is Neal's painting. It was his vision, wasn't it?
Yeah. I mean, he really believed it was a Delaroche. So if we can prove it is a Delaroche, it would be something very special.
We're about to find out. Professor Stephen Bann is heading to the gallery to give us his verdict.
Point. There's been quite a lot of doubt because there were so many different versions. But this is probably the first time I'm thinking maybe it really could be the thing, you know. I think it's the closest we've got so far, isn't it? It's amazing. That was so exciting. And for Becky, it was a real turning point. She now believes that Neal's painting could be the genuine Delaroche. What we still don't know, though, is Neal's painting the one that we saw in that National Watercolour? We still can't be sure about that. Neal's could be a copy. We've still got work to do on that score.
Delaroche was painting at a time when it was standard practice for copies to be made of his works by students or artists in his circle. But were any made of St. Amélie? I've come to France on a mission to hunt them down. If I can identify all the replicas that were painted, hopefully I can rule out Neal's painting as one of them. I've come to Prignac in Bordeaux, to the Church of Saint-Pierre. I've been given a tip-off. There's a copy of St. Amélie hanging here.
This is St. Amélie, this is it. This is our image, but expanded 50 or 60 times. So this was done in 1844, 12 years after the painting by Delaroche. And it was an official copy, something done with the permission of the king and queen themselves. And it's by an artist called Leontine Tacussel. Even though it's been heavily restored, I think you can tell there are definite weaknesses when you compare it to ours. I don't think the faces are anything like as fine. It's almost as if they've been inflated with a bicycle pump. And actually, it's a not dissimilar story in the landscape behind. Here it looks a bit like a sort of theatrical backdrop. It's not as convincing.
It's reassuring to see that Neal's picture is much more finely painted than this copy. This is what you'd expect if it's the original Delaroche. But I may be judging unfairly. The copy recently underwent extensive restoration, and to make some proper comparisons, I really need to see an image of the picture before work took place. Stephanie Richard from the local Heritage Association has agreed to meet me to share what she knows.
Stephanie, bonjour, comment ça va?
Bonjour, très bien, et vous?
Très bien, merci.
This is what the painting looked like before restoration.
Uh-huh, that's of some concern. There are distinct differences in the colouring when you compare it to ours. I mean, look at the function. They're going to be big. They're going to put over the message. Mm.
The only thing is, seeing these two church paintings now side by side for the first time, they look very similar, particularly when it comes to the colours. But they don't look similar to Neal's.
Yeah, if Neal's is going to be the lost picture, we have to work out why on earth the colours are different from what we know the known copies are. And the only thing that's going to help us with that, I suspect at this stage, is forensics. Mm. So, how far have you got tracking where the lost Delaroche went?
Not very good, I'm afraid. Only up to Mary Amelie's death in 1866.
And then we've got this huge gap between then and when it emerges on the market, when Neal buys the painting in the 1980s. And I have to say, I don't like that gap at all. We've nothing there.
I need to find out what happened to Queen Mary Amelie's art collection after her death in 1866. So I've returned to France. I'm heading to the National Archives in Paris. The papers of the French royal family are held here. It's the largest private archive in Europe, amounting to 40 tons of documents. I'm hoping Marie Amélie's will can shed some light on where her treasured Delaroche ended up.
So we've got Queen Marie Amélie will, diamonds, portraits.
Queen Mary Amélie, notes, silver, paintings. So let's look in here. I mean, this is fascinating to be able to peer into her life in this way. It's a list of all the silver at Claremont. It's a long list here of all her porcelain. Ah, paintings. Here we go. Right at the top of the list, Sainte-Amélie de la Roche. Brilliant. And actually, it's also the most valuable. £1,200. And that's saying something, because there's a Van Dyck in here, and that's worth less. So at the top of the list, and the most valuable in her will, is the Sainte-Amélie by de la Roche. But it doesn't say who she left it to.
A search through another file reveals a list made by Mary Amélie's son, the Duc de Nemours, requesting certain objects that had belonged to his mother.
Oh, here we go, here we go. La Sainte-Amélie de la Roche. So it looks like, therefore, the painting that she loved so much went to her son, to the Duc de Nemours.
The Duc de Nemours lived at Bushy House in Twickenham, so we can assume Sainte-Amélie hung there. But where did it go after his death in 1896?
Well, this is the will of the Duc de Nemours. And in it, he says that he leaves all his paintings to his son, and then says, and there is a list of those paintings in amongst his papers. But in 1848.
And by all accounts, Mary Amélie was very religious, and it's documented that in 1831, Paul de la Roche was commissioned to paint a picture of her patron saint, Saint Amélie, and it was designed to be a model for a stained glass window in the Queen's private chapel.
And we've seen the original sketch by de la Roche for this design, but experts say that the original picture is lost.
It's clearly an important painting, commissioned for the Queen, no less, and of her patron saint.
Well, in fact, it was important enough to be exhibited in the prestigious Paris Salon of 1834. Here's the catalogue entry, Sainte-Amélie, and it says there that the picture belonged to the King.
Does it list the dimensions of the lost picture?
It doesn't, but I have found an exhibition catalogue from 1857, which states very clearly that the dimensions were 42 centimetres high and 28 centimetres wide.
So, Neil's is 44. This is 29. Well, that's a bit of a worry, isn't it? Because if this painting is the lost original, you'd expect the dimensions to be the same.
Yeah, and there's also other niggling concerns. I mean, we know that the engraving is a copy of the lost picture. For Neil's to be the lost picture, they've therefore pretty well got to look identical. Unfortunately, there are some differences. I wonder whether you can spot them.
Well, if you look at the plant pot, for example, or the jardiniere, if you want to be fancy about it, in Neil's painting it's completely plain, whereas in the engraving it's richly decorated.
And the face of the middle servant in Neil's picture is far less detailed than the one you see in the engraving.
And then there's the cloth. In the engraving it's a richly decorated material, whereas in Neil's painting it's just like a bit of canvas.
And have a look at the step in the engraving. You can see beautifully clearly in Gothic writing, de la Roche. In the painting, there is nothing.
But I wonder if that inscription might have been added by the engraver, because sometimes engravers used to do that, used to fiddle with pictures and add little bits in.
Yeah, and I also think there is possibly another explanation, and that is some later restorer has touched in areas, has changed them, skewing the eye and making the experts think that it's a copy.
Well, forensic analysis should help us with that. And I want to find out more about the original painting, its royal connection, and how a royal treasure could be lost.
To find out more about de la Roche's lost Sainte-Amélie, owner Becky and I are travelling to France. We've come to Normandy and the glorious Chateau d'Eau. Built in the 16th century, this was once the summer palace of King Louis-Philippe.
Circle. But were any made of Sainte-Amélie? I've come to France on a mission to hunt them down. If I can identify all the replicas that were painted, hopefully I can rule out Neil's painting as one of them. I've come to Prignac in Bordeaux, to the church of Saint-Pierre.
I've been given a tip-off. There's a copy of St. Amelie hanging here.
This is St. Amelie. This is it. This is our image, but expanded 50 or 60 times. So this was done in 1844, 12 years after the painting by Delaroche. And it was an official copy, something done with the permission of the king and queen themselves. And it's by an artist called Leontine Tacussel. Even though it's been heavily restored, I think you can tell there are definite weaknesses when you compare it to ours. I don't think the faces are anything like as fine. It's almost as if they've been inflated with a bicycle pump. And actually, it's a not dissimilar story in the landscape behind. Here it looks a bit like a sort of theatrical backdrop. It's not as convincing.
It's reassuring to see that Neil's picture is much more finely painted than this copy. This is what you'd expect if it's the original Delaroche. But I may be judging unfairly. The copy recently underwent extensive restoration, and to make some proper comparisons, I really need to see an image of the picture before work took place. Stephanie Richard from the local Heritage Association has agreed to meet me to share what she knows.
Stephanie, bonjour, comment ça va?
Bonjour, très bien, et vous?
Très bien, merci.
This is what the painting looked like before restoration.
Uh-huh. That's of some concern. There are distinct differences in the colouring when you compare it to ours. I mean, look at the figure in the far right. In our picture, she's got a blue dress. Here, she's green. And then the kneeling figure in the middle of the three, the dress is yellow. In ours, it's distinctly white.
But the most troubling difference is the dress of St. Amelie herself. On Neil's painting, it's gold. But on the copy, it's golden red. If this is a faithful replica of the original, we're in trouble.
Now, what we really need to know is, could Leontine Tacussel have had access to the original Paul Delaroche picture?
Yes. This is a letter that informs us that Leontine Tacussel had access to the original painting of Paul Delaroche.